The prime race we are going to look at has been initiated by the number theorists Godfrey Hardy and John Littlewood over 90 years ago. The race deals with two types of primes. The L primes are the primes of the form 4k plus 3. The H primes are the primes for which p minus 1 is a square. We call Ln the set of 4k plus 3 primes up to n, and Hn the set of all k smaller or equal to n for which k squared plus 1 is prime. The relevance of these two classes will be clarified later. Let's experiment. For n equal 10, for example, there are two L primes of the form 4k plus 3, which are smaller or equal than 10. We have L 10 is equal to 2. Then there are five integers, k equal 1, 2, 4, 6, and 10, smaller or equal than 10, for which k squared plus 1 is prime. The ratio of H 10 over L 10 is 2.5. For n equal 1 million, there are already 39,322 Littlewood primes and 54,110 Hardy primes. The ratio is 1.375. And for n equal 1 trillion, there are about 19 billion Littlewood primes and 16 billion Hardy primes. The ratio has not changed, 1.3728. The first experiments have been done by human calculators. They were hired by Hardy and Littlewood, and some of the first to have used computers to do experiments in number theory were Daniel Shanks and Marin Wunderlich. So Wunderlich computed the prime race until 1.3 times 10 to the 7. In the 60s, the computer equipment was, of course, still quite primitive. Daniel Shanks mentions having done work on an IBM 704. That machine computed with vacuum tubes and had a whopping 32 kilobytes of memory. Still, even with this primitive equipment, computer scientists at that time were able to write musing programs and build first speech recognition, so the IBM 704 could sing. This inspired Stanley Kubrick in his famous 2001 Space Odyssey movie. There, astronaut Dave deactivates HAL, a rogue computer who has killed everybody else on board. So HAL, close to faint and die, starts to sing. So of course, computers today have become stronger. We follow now almost 50 years of Moore's law. So last year, I ran the prime race up to n equal to 10 to the 11, which is 10,000 times more than what Wunderlich did when this was the last time the computation of the race I'm aware of. So I have since continued to run a process on my office machine, which, like HAL, also has an eye watching towards the Cambridge Commons. So here you see the development of the ratio H over L. In the summer there had been a sharp drop which recovered slowly over the fall. In the winter there is a long positive surprise. Now in the spring it slowly seems to go down again. So here is the recording of the HAL who watches the window and takes a picture every day. So this is January, winter surprise, February. So even with such large numbers, we test primes of the order 10 to the 24. The difference to the conjectured limit is of the similar order of magnitude than the error which Wunderlich saw 50 years ago. When taking intervals of, say, 10 million and plot the quotient H over L, where H is the number of H primes and L the number of L primes in that interval, we see a much more regular picture. The statistics of the data look Gaussian, as if the individual patches were independent of each other. We suspect that the distribution becomes Gaussian, with mean C and variance going to zero if the patches, if the intervals getting longer. We did not see yet why the two classes L and H are natural. So in order to understand the importance, we have to go into the complex plane. We will explain the following picture. The L primes are the real Gaussian primes in a strip from 0 to n, and the H primes are the almost real Gaussian primes in a strip from 0 to n. The Gaussian integers, their primes, have been introduced by Gauss in 1831. We see on this slide the paper of Gauss, which shows the first appearance of this concept. So here, the Gaussian primes are plotted in the complex plane. So the primes are the Gaussian integers a plus ib, which are only divisible by a unit or then by itself. The units are the Gaussian integers 1, minus 1, I, and minus I. And some of the real primes are Gaussian primes, like 3 or 7. But 5 is not a Gaussian prime, as 5 can be factored as 2 plus I times 2 minus I. But both factors, 2 plus I and 2 minus I, are prime. Now the L primes are the Gaussian primes on the positive real axis, and the H primes are the Gaussian primes on the axis I equal 1, where the norm n is a prime. We call them almost real. So up to n equal to 10, there are 2 real primes and 5 almost real primes. So 2 plus I, for example, is an almost real prime, because 2 squared plus 1 squared is 5 is prime. Much of the structure of the Gaussian primes is mysterious, but also much of the structure is known. There are 3 types of primes. So the norm is a squared plus b squared. Don't take the square root. And Gaussian prime is prime. It is either real and prime of the form 4k plus 3, or then if the norm is prime, in that case, they are either 4k plus 1, na plus ib is 4k plus 1, or then na plus ib is equal to 2. A Gaussian integer is called even if it is divisible by one of the primes with na plus ib is equal to 2. Here we see a larger window with the Gaussian primes. The color has been chosen according to the distance to the nearest other prime, and here we go even further away. As we know that primes become rarer further away, this also happens with Gaussian primes. However, we have almost no idea about the detailed distribution of rows, especially on rows or columns. We don't even know whether there exists a row or a column without Gaussian primes. This is the highway crossing frog problems for Gaussian primes. Let's zoom out a little bit and you see the primes become sparser further away. Gaussian primes have a natural dihedral symmetry. See, the first octant sector repeats 8 times. And so if you glue the positive real axis with the line A equal B in the first quadrant, we get the Gaussian prime orbifold where the symmetry has been factored out. So what do we know about these two classes? So the Hardy-Littlewood experiments have shown that, that there are more Hardy primes, and the fraction seems to converge. But we only know about the Littlewood primes. We know that there are infinitely many L primes. By the way, the Euclid's proof by contradiction works. We assume that there are only finitely many, and then we form the number 4 as the product of the pk minus 1. But we don't know whether there are infinitely many H primes. This is a famous open problem of Landau. So here's the Landau conjecture. So one can rephrase it as there are infinitely many primes P for which P minus 1 is square. Or then we can say there are infinitely many squares B square for which B square plus 1 is prime. So here are a few mathematicians who pondered prime numbers. It has been done for thousands of years. Euclid studied them and proved that infinitely many Gauss introduced the Gaussian primes. You've just heard about Landau. Bundyakovsky formulated a much more general conjecture on primes which matters in related situations. But here is the constant, the Hardy-Littlewood constant. So in an almost prophetic paper of 1923, Hardy and Littlewood made quantitative statements. So they introduced this constant given in the, as a product. And so the prediction is that ln over hn converges to this constant for n going to infinity. So p1 are the primes, where 4k plus 1, and p3 are the primes, 4k plus 3. So here is the original statement, conjecture E, in their paper of 1923. So the L density is hidden here as the square root of n over log n, which is known. And so the this statement is equivalent to what we have just seen. But the intuition has been pushed further by others like Bateman and Horn. One can rewrite the constant as a product over all primes involving the number WP, which tells how many solutions the equation k squared plus 1 equals 0 has, modulo p. So there are either two solutions or zero solution. And so this leads to the question whether a minus 1 is a quantitative residue or not, to be or not to be. That is the question. And so if p is equal to 4k plus 3, then minus 1 is not a quadratic residue, while if p divides k squared plus 1, then minus 1 is a quadratic residue. And so this leads to this, P1, team 1 and team 3, the primes of the form 4k plus 1, primes of the form 4k plus 3, and which they seem to be pretty random. And so this leads to another prime race, which of the two classes grows faster, or which ones are ahead more. And Granville and Martin have written a paper about that about 10 years ago. This story is very interesting also from the history of computing point of view, because Hardy and Littlewood mention on page 62 of their paper that some of their conjectures have been tested numerically by Mrs. Stratfield, Dr. A.E. Western and Mr. O. Western. And these guys were really, you know, they had the paper and pencils or computing that constant, and they actually got four decimal places already when summing over three primes. So instead of the product over infinitely many primes, just take this first three primes, 5, 13, and 17, and got then a value which is already quite good. In this context, there are other conjectures. Last spring, I read the booklet of Barry Mazur and William Stein on primes. In one exercise, they asked to come up with new conjectures. So that's what I did last summer. My conjecture is that every Gaussian integer a plus ib with a and b bigger one is a sum of two positive Gaussian primes. And this is close to the binary Goldbach conjecture, which was formulated in 1742. So it's also natural because it's in the calculus setup, the story looks the same. So the rational Goldbach conjecture can be written in calculus form. You define first a function, an analytic function f involving the primes, and then you square that function and you look at the even derivatives at zero, and they should all be non-zero for k bigger than one. While for the Gaussian Goldbach, you also define a real analytic function of two variables, and then there should be non-zero second, even partial derivatives at 0, 0 for k bigger than 1. So here is a kind of a computed how many times, using this analytic expressions, how many times a number can be written, and even a Gaussian integer can be written as a sum of two Gaussian primes. And you see really that we need the a bigger one, b bigger one, and we also need the evenness. The even ones are have a yellow square around. And so there's a relation with the Landau conjectures. If the Landau conjecture was wrong, were only finitely many Hardy primes, then also the Gaussian Goldbach conjecture would fail. And the reason is because it's at the boundary where the Goldbach conjecture is the most difficult. And you would have to write in the second row the number as a sum of two primes using the first row. So it's not the first conjecture on Goldbach in number fields. So Hans Rademacher already worked on that in the 20s. And then in the 60s, there was some work with Mitsui, Kerner, Holman, and Jordan. But nobody seems to have covered the conjecture which we just formulated before. So Rademacher's work is quite impressive. He extends the Winograph type results, 24, 25, and then Mitsui and Kerner pushed this further in the 60, 61. Holman and Jordan, they have a precise sector conjecture which deals with, so if every even Gaussian integers can be written as two sum of two Gaussian primes, which are in some sector, 45 degrees. They have also a weak conjecture, which we will formulate again later. And there are other conjectures in for Eisenstein integers. So Eisenstein integers are integers of the form a plus wb, where w is a complex third root of 1 in the first quadrant. And so there is this Eisenstein-Goldbach conjecture. Every Eisenstein integer a plus ib with a bigger than 3, b bigger than 3 is a sum of two positive Eisenstein primes. Note there is no evenness required. And why a bigger than 3 and not bigger than 1, like before, they are just two nasty guys which appear to be unique exceptions. It seems that the b for 2 case is safe. But they are Eisenstein ghosts, which appear for b equal to 3. That's why we ask that a and b are bigger than 3. So here are two elegant open problems. Every even Gaussian integer is a sum of two Gaussian primes. It was just appeared in that paper we have seen. Another elegant guess is that every Eisenstein integer is a sum of two Eisenstein primes. So that computer, you can test it for small primes. But back to the race, the Hardy-Littlewood conjectures would settle the Landau conjecture. But how does the race continue? Are there fluctuations? Or is there? Does it settle to this limit C, as Hardy and Littlewood have predicted? Or does the very unlikely event happen that the limit is zero and Landau is false? We have no idea. But you can try yourself. So here's the PARI program, PARI code, which I use, which is still running on my, on HAL's. HAL is still running this, and it's so small it can be even tweeted. PARI has a nice feature. It has a small footprint. You can run it on your machine in the background. You don't feel it. So this is the end. For more information, look at the two reports on the archive.